we've been in business for over 20 years. This evening, you are the third community meeting of our community meetings that are being held. And I guess the one thing that I want to emphasize to you is we want your input. That's what we are here for. So, basically, how this process started is we started with the facility assessment of all 19 elementary schools. We at ADM Group walked each of the facilities, and we not only looked at the physical condition of the facilities, so that would mean your flooring, your paint, the condition of our roofing, the mechanical systems, electrical systems, security, fencing, if there's any kind of security in your reception areas. We also assess the utilization of each of the spaces in the facility. The second thing we're here to do this evening is share options. What are the options out there for your elementary schools? The third, like I said earlier, is collection of input. We want community input. The district is asking you to tell them how you feel about things. And then after we're done with all our community meetings, we are going to go back and report all our findings, all everything that you've told us to the governing board in March. So again, our main purpose for the master plan process is get community input and then have a master plan developed with the vision and mission of Scottsdale Unified School District. So this evening at the end of the presentation, we are videotaping the presentation this evening so that we can put it on the district's website at the end of the five community meetings. So if anybody can't come, they have the ability to see the presentation. But we ask for this meeting that you hold your questions to the end. We're also going to be handing out a questionnaire that's going to ask you to rate some of the important things to you. So the way this questionnaire is set up is, number one, we ask, are you a parent? Are you a community member? And what school are you affiliated with? The top portion of this, we know all these are important. Of course, safety and efficiency in learning environments is important. Minimize travel time, that's important too. We know these are all very important to you, but what we'd like you to do is put a 1 through 5 by each of the items, number 1 being the least important, number 5 being the most important. The second half of this page here is, what are your top 3 considerations? What is most important to you? Is it right-sizing school facilities? Is it consolidation of school facilities? Is it making the schools more efficient, energy efficient? Is it eliminating any kind of school programs? That type of thing. So again, please put an X by your top 3 important considerations. At the bottom of your form, you will also find an area for comments. And that's for anything that we might not have included up here, any considerations that you have on your particular school, because we know these are very personal issues, and so if you have a particular concern on the school that you are affiliated with, please add that. We also have an email address that if you think of something after the presentation and you want to send us an email, please do so. That will be on the questionnaire, but that email address is SUSD. E is in elementary, M is in master, P is in plan, at admgroupinc.com. So with that, let's talk about what we're really trying to go for. Many schools are over 40 years old in this district, some even older than that. So we'd like to improve the quality of life with the neighborhood and its communities. We want to address the location of the current buildings, where they're located. So, you know, are the demographics changing? That's been a question that's come up, which we will address in the presentation. where the schools are located today and the boundaries, and also the capacity of the schools and how they're being utilized. We also need to look at the condition of the facilities and the grounds. So in order to do that, we've looked at how do each school compare to another. There's some inequity, some schools are, you know, over 50 years old, and then some schools are brand new. So obviously each school is not going to be treated the same way. We definitely want to make sure that the schools are positioned for 21st century learning. And so with that, of course, comes technology and other things to consider. And then we need to prioritize the needs of school. We'd like to say money's never an issue. We know it is. So what's most important? Where does it make sense to spend money on your schools? And we want to make sure that that's equitable to all the schools. And how are we going to deal with the maintenance and repair of the elementary schools today? So this is just a little timeline. If you're not familiar with what the district has done in the past, or if you're new to the district, in 2004 there was a high school bond approved for $218 million, six projects, all were completed on time and under budget. In 2009, elementary school consolidation was completed without bond funds. In 2010, middle school bond was approved for $118 million, which included 16 projects. Again, all completed on time and within budget. In 2011, the H2 group did a facility assessment of the elementary schools. 2014, last year, we started, ADM group did the assessment of the elementary schools as well, and that brings us to today, to 2015, going for your community feedback. So what happens after this? The question has been asked on the timeline. Well, as I mentioned, we started this back in August of 2014. We started our community meetings on January 21st. Our last community meeting is next Wednesday night. We will then go to the governing board and report our findings on March 24th. And then based on governing board input, it'll be decided where we go from here. Should any plans be developed, we have an option of coming back, presenting to the community our findings, and report back to the governing board. So what you're going to see is an information sheet on all schools, of all the 19 schools. So let me emphasize, we only looked at schools, no other facilities. This is just kind of a summary of the school, the year it was built, how many years old, and the condition it was in. The most important thing I want you to get out of this slide is seven of your schools are 54 years or older. That was pretty surprising, actually, when we started to put everything together. If you look at the years built column, you'll notice some of the schools have multiple years. So for instance, if you look up at Cherokee, it was originally built in 1974, but you're gonna see another year of 1994. So what that means is the district came back and did either renovations or an addition to that school. So let me start with Anasazi and explain to you how this is set up. So you'll notice these are floor plans of how the school is. We have an arrow at the front of the school just to orientate you in case you're not familiar with the school. There's a color coding to each one of these schools. The dark blue with the grade level on it indicates it's a full-size classroom with its grade level. The light blue that you see here is it's a full-size classroom, but today it does not hold a full grade level. It may hold a small pull-out group, it may hold a one-on-one teaching instance, so it's not being utilized as a full classroom. The yellow area here our common areas. So it's the media center, the gymnasium, the cafeteria like we're sitting in here today. The pre-K and Panda groups are in the peach up here. Full day special ed, which doesn't apply to this particular slide, is shown in purple. And then administration and support is in green. Anything that is not being utilized is gray, which you see that they have two in this particular school. And that means that room is literally not being used for any use. So in some instances, the district is not providing, you know, any air or anything to that to try to make it a little more efficient. And then we also have a dark gray usage, which you will see on some schools, which is district use. So the district is trying to utilize some of the rooms for uses so that we can make this more utilized. Each slide you will see will have the information here on the right. When it was built, so in case of the Anasazi, it was built in 1996. It's 19 years old. Light renovations are recommended, and its utilization is 77%. So I know the big question has been, how did you guys come up with the utilization? What we did is when we walked through each campus, we noted what each space was being utilized today. That was as of November 2014. So we knew if it was a full classroom, if it was a classroom in lieu that was had a very small group in it, if it was used for PE, whatever the use might be. We then took the Scottsdale Unified School District standards of number of students per classroom. So for instance, kindergarten, the standard is 21 students. As you move up the grade levels, the number of students increase. In the case of pre-K and Panda, those are 18 students per classroom. So they all have different utilization numbers associated with it. So when we figure our utilization factor here, that's how we came up with it. And I'll talk about how that differs a little bit later on some other slides when it comes to school facilities board and that type of thing. So, in general, utilization of 75% or above for an elementary school is a good utilization. The current enrollment today at Anasazi, as of November 2014, which also includes pre-K and Panda, is 594 students. Now, there's some information out there on our numbers were not matching some of the numbers maybe that the public had received. And the reason there was a difference is because they did not include the pre-K and Panda numbers. So that was the difference in the enrollment numbers. So again, all numbers that you see on current enrollment will be as of November 2014 and do include pre-K and Panda. And that is because they are utilizing those classrooms, so we needed to include those. The second lines on the bottom there, you'll see the district hired the applied economics to do an analysis on demographics. Everybody wants to know what's going to happen for the future. And so applied economics study indicated what was going to happen from 2013-2014 all the way up to 2024. We've included the numbers for 2017 and 2019. So in the case of Anasazi, you'll see for 2017, they go down to 591 students, and for 2019, they go up to 605 students. And again, all those numbers, so we made an apples to apples comparison, included the pre-K and Panda students. So our next one is our Katie Neighborhood Learning Center. K through 8 was built in 2013. It's only 2 years old, so it's in excellent condition. No work is recommended for that school for obvious reasons. Utilization is 83%. The current enrollment is 464 as of November 2014. The projected enrollment for 2017 is 526. And for 2019, 527. So you can see in this case, it went up a little bit. You'll also note that it has a few blue areas, but not that many. So that's why the utilization is a little higher on this one. Cherokee Elementary School, built in 1974, which are some of you are familiar with this one. Entrance is located over here. It's 41 years old. Major renovations are recommended. Its utilization is 75%. Current enrollment for November 2014 is 604. Projected enrollment for 2017 goes down a little bit to 570, and 2019 to 558. Tara's killing me up here. Okay, next one up is Cheyenne Elementary School. So Cheyenne was built in 1996. It's 19 years old. Light renovations are recommended. However, one thing in looking at it, some of you may know it started as K through 5 school. It's now K through 8. The picture up there on your right-hand side is their current PE room, which is quite small. So getting your upper classes in there might be a little cozy. So we had recommended a new gym and science lab building be built on that campus to bring equity up to the K through 8 schools. Utilization, very good at 90%. Current enrollment as of November 2014 is 1,003. Projected enrollment for 2017 is going up to 1,121. And just a few students in 2019 to 1,123. So again, if you look at it, we have just a couple light blue spots and lots of dark blue. So that's a good thing. Cochise was built in 2001. It's 14 years old. Light renovations are recommended. Utilization, 86%. Current enrollment for November 2014 is 605. Projected enrollment 2017 goes down a little bit to 522, and then goes down to 504 in 2019, again including pre-K and PANDA students. Copper Ridge Elementary School, K through 8, built in 2001, it's 14 years old. Light renovations recommended, utilization 81%. I might point out on this slide here, you'll notice some of the gray classrooms here, which are classrooms not being utilized. You also see some of that purple color that I was telling you about in there. And then the current enrollment in November 2014 is 1138. Projected enrollment for 2017 is 1223. And for 2019, 1170. So it's gone, went up, came down a little bit. Desert Canyon. Desert Canyon was built in 1998, 17 years old. Light renovations are recommended. This picture up here on the right-hand side is their existing PE space, which I believe was an old art room. So we recommended for this school that a new addition for the interior PE space be considered. Its utilization is 76%. The current enrollment for November 2014 was 532. Projected enrollment from Applied Economics for 2017 was 478. And in 2019, 484. Hohokam. This is one of the older schools. It was built in 1960, so it's 55 years old. One of the things that's different about Hohokam, if you've ever been there, is you enter from this direction here, and the first building that you hit is the cafeteria. So you actually have no administration to hit before you get into the school site. So pretty much when we visited, we just walked on campus and we had to essentially go to the interior of the space to find the administration building. A possible consideration for this campus would be rebuilding the school, which you probably saw the term right size, and right size in this instance might be if the community decided you want to keep a school in that area, then maybe you don't build as big a school as it is there. In other cases, your population is much larger, your utilization is higher, maybe you want to make it builder. But again, that's for you guys to say, and that's what we are here to listen to. We heard a lot in the first community meeting, neighborhood schools. Second community meeting talked about consolidation. So these are just suggestions up here. Utilization for Hobocom is 55%. The occupancy in November 2014, 484. Their projected enrollment for 2017 is 517. And it goes down to 493 in 2019. So if you take a look at this one, if Tara will go back. You notice that we have a lot of gray up here, and so that's affecting some of their utilization. And we have a good amount of light blue. If you start to look in a lot of the buildings, you'll see it in most of the buildings. Next one is Hopi. Hopi is a totally different animal. It was built in 1961. It's 54 years old. And one of the considerations for this school would be possibly rebuilding it. Utilization is the highest of all the elementary schools, sitting at 99%. So you can see by looking at it that there are tons and tons of full classrooms utilized. Their current enrollment for November 2014 is 838. Projected enrollment for 2017 is 842. And for 2019 is 829. Kiva Elementary was built in 1957, another older school. It's 58 years old. Again, this school, because of the age of the school, the asbestos that's in there, the cost of energy, which I'll talk about a little bit later, could be a candidate to rebuild the school. The utilization is 65%. Current enrollment for November 2014 is 489. Projected enrollment for 2017 from Applied Economics is 506. And 2019, 584. Laguna Elementary School, which is a K-5, was built in 1987, 28 years old. Light renovations recommended. It's got a very good utilization of 87%. Current enrollment for November 2014 is 681. Projected enrollment for 2017 is 649. And 2019, 661. Navajo Elementary School, which is a K-5, is a STEM academy. It was built in 1960. It's 55 years old. And again, another potential candidate to rebuild, possibly. But you can see here that there's a lot of blue sitting here. So again, not utilized to its full capacity by any means. We also have some gray space that's not being utilized, and also some district use here. The current enrollment for 2014 is 394. It's projected to go up in 2017 to 430, and down a little bit in 2019 to 420. Pima Elementary School, K-5, was built in 1959. It's 56 years old. Another candidate for possible rebuild. Utilization is 69%. The occupancy of November 2014 is 558. And the enrollments projected by Applied Economics to go up to 592 in 2017 and drop a little bit to 557 in 2019. Pueblo Elementary School, K-5, was built in 1971. It's 44 years old. Getting a little bit on the older side, and the district was able to bring up its utilization because of the pre-K panda usage up here. So you can see all the peach up there is that area. One of the thoughts was the school could possibly share it with the Boys and Girls Club. I don't know if you're aware, a lot of school districts are doing that today where they'll build a school or have a school near a Boys and Girls Club so that the Boys and Girls Club can support the community with after-hours programs. So therefore, the utilization is pretty good at 79%. There is a current Boys and Girls Club close to that, but unfortunately, it's being talked that it could possibly close due to the condition of their facilities. The current enrollment at Pueblo is 2014. For 2014, it's 624. I'm going down just a little bit in 2017 to 622, and down in 2019, 588. Redfield Elementary School, K through 5, was built in 1989. Young school, the light of things. 26 years old, light renovations recommended. Utilization is 61%. So you can see in this case, we have one whole building that is not being utilized at this time. Current enrollment for November 2014 is 549. Projected enrollment for 2017 is up a little bit at 563, and in 2019 it goes up to 576. Sequoia, built in 1988, 27 years old. Light renovations recommended. Utilization is 62%. So again, you can see there's a couple rooms over here that are gray, and these rooms over here are gray. And then we've got a fairly good amount of the light blue. The occupancy as of November 2014 is 467. The projected enrollment for 2017 is 476 and goes down to 470 in 2019. Tavon Elementary School is a K through 5. This is one that has been built in sections. It was first built in 1955 with additions in the 1990s and the 2000s. Some of the older pieces are 60 years old, so the recommendation might be replacement of the older buildings only so that we could relocate the kindergarten across to this campus. The kindergarten is currently across the street, so that means there's a safety factor there that the kindergarten is not on the same site as the rest of the school. They also have portable classrooms, so an option would be to get rid of these as well. And then the annex that is currently housing the kindergarten can be used for an early learning center. Utilization is 81%. Enrollment for November 2014 is 739. 2017 applied economics has it dropping to 651 and dropping to 633 in 2019. Conalea Elementary School is a K through 5, fairly new, built in 2004 and 2007 as an alternative school. It's 8 to 11 years old, and one of the options is possibly to move that school to the 68th Street campus, which we will have a slide following of that campus, and then use the current campus for other district and community programs. You can see, though, that there's only really two light blue classes in this area, so the utilization is high at 70%. The current enrollment for November 2014 is 346, goes up to 389 in 2017, and down to 373 in 2019. This is the site of the 68th Street site. Should the decision be to relocate Tonalea and rebuild on this property? And then our last one is Yavapai. Yavapai was originally built in 1961 and it was renovated in 2011. It's 54 years old, however, no work is recommended since bond funds were utilized back in 2011. The school is in excellent condition. Unfortunately, the only problem is that it's not utilization is fairly low. In order to kind of work on that, the district has moved their nutritional services up there. But you can see we have a couple gray and then a lot of the light blue. And that's because at Yaddo High, most of those classrooms are full-size classrooms used by one-on-one teaching. Current enrollment is 432, projected to go to in 2017, 430, and 403 in 2019. So that's the end of our 19 school tour. Went much quicker for you, believe me. In any case, there's other things to consider. Even if you decided you didn't want to do anything to the schools, there are some roofing issues out there on your schools. So an assessment was done of all the roofs, looking at possibly replacing or doing repairs to the existing roofs. Roofs are very important because if you have those roof leaks, as I'm sure some of you have experienced in the rains recently, if you have a leak, it's going to come down and distort everything in your facility. So your computers, your interior finishes, and that's not fun for anybody. So looking at it, it's got an estimated cost associated with it of $10 million to $17 million. Also, security upgrades might be an option that you guys want to look at. Recently, we've worked with a number of school districts, and with everything that's happened in the last couple of years, security has become a very big issue. So some of our districts have chose to add extra security. Most of your schools, I can tell you from personal experience, if I wanted to get in there, I could just whip by the administrative staff. So unfortunately, you'd like to say that's not going to happen, but we all know some bad people are out there. So you can do everything from adding additional fencing to adding a buzzer where the front desk would have to buzz somebody in onto the campus. Some of the districts have gone all the way to the extreme of putting bulletproof glass in their administration areas. So there's a lot of options there, but an estimated cost for that is $7.5 million to $9 million. And then technology. We all know technology just keeps changing and changing and changing. And in order for our students to keep up to date on everything that's happening out there and have what they need when they come out of school, we would look at doing upgrades at schools, and that estimated cost is $6 million to $10 million. Another thing for consideration may be new artificial turfs at Coronado, Desert Mountain, and Swirl High Schools. Your other high schools already have artificial turf. Some of the benefits of artificial turf, obviously, you don't have to water. That's a good thing. It's better for the environment, you don't have to mow. That's another good thing. I can say from experience, going to Terra Sun's Pop Warner game at Arcadia, it can generate income. They charge us to get in it. And then, obviously, it's going to last longer. So estimated costs for that would be $3 million. So, energy efficiency. Something to consider, because a lot of your schools are older and do require more money for the energy. So we looked at the district's costs. We got the cost from the district. We looked at the cost of water, gas, electricity to come up with this slide. So the first number that you see up here is 77 cents. So if you build a new school today with all the energy efficient technology out there, and this number is according to the US GBC, which is the United States Green Building Council, it could cost you 77 cents a square foot for that facility. Now, let's take Yaddo High that was renovated in 2011. A new chiller system was added to that school, so obviously the energy efficiency is better. And so Yaddo High is sitting at $1.08 per square foot. So then we said, okay, let's take a look at some of the older schools within the district. Just to kind of give you an average cost for the older schools. And that cost is $1.57. So for fun, we thought, okay, what does that mean to anybody? Do you really care? So we have Kiva. Kiva is what we call the energy hog. It requires the most energy usage. So we said, all right, if we take Kiva and we're gonna rebuild it, let's take a look at that scenario. So currently, Kiva is 63,000 square feet. and the energy cost per kiva is $2.64 per square foot. If we then turned around and we bought and we built a new efficient school, but again, taking into consideration the current population, the utilization, the demographics, we're saying, okay, I think Kiva maybe could be built at 57,750 square feet times that 70 cents a square foot, the district could save $122,000 a year in energy costs. So, a lot of questions have come up on demographics. So, we refer to the applied economic analysis, again done in 2013 and 2014, and you can kind of see by this graph, the different learning communities, what the projections are. Now, to be honest with you, you know, we started in 2014, study goes out to 2023. It's kind of a guess, okay? So I don't want you to get tied to it, but everybody asks for the information, we want to provide it. So the top one, the blue line up here, is Desert Mountain Learning Community. It is projected at the highest growth of 11.4% over 10 years. The yellow line here is the Chaparral Learning Community. And it actually, as you can see, is dropping 5.4%. The green is the Arcadia Learning Community, and it drops just a little bit, 0.3%. The next one is the Coronado Learning Community, and it drops 0.1%. And then the last one here is Swirl Learning Community, and it drops 4.2% over 10 years. So just to reiterate, all these numbers here that you see in this projection, this represents the number of students, is based including on the pre-K and PANDA functions. Other things to consider is the district met with the city of Scottsdale, the senior long-range planners, to see what's happening in Scottsdale, what could happen, who's building, what's coming in that could make a difference on your schools. So some of the things going on are the McDowell Road corridor, which affects Coronado, and most of that's retail. There's a downtown Scottsdale with Arcadia, Coronado, and Squirrel that has 5 to 10% of the units they think that would bring families to the district. And then the Air Park area, the Chaparral Learning Community, is mainly industrial, but there could be a few possible students. Now I can tell you, as we've been giving these presentations, the district's been notified through this process that new housing developments are going up. You know, so it's anybody's guess, honestly. And obviously there are other factors happening within your communities that are going to affect the demographics. So with that, what are the priorities? Obviously, priority one is health and life safety. Priority two, ADA, which is American Disabilities Act, accessibility for handicapped students is number two. Priority number three, program support, upgrades and infrastructure. Again, some of that technology and what's important to support the learning environment. Priority four, the building shell and envelope integrity. So again, envelope integrity, we're talking about the roofing. Number five, classroom interior upgrades and infrastructure. Yes, it's nice to have pretty carpet, nice paint, but probably not the highest priority. And number six, athletic fields, site development, and landscaping. So, in summary, we're back to our little chart again, with all the schools listed, the years it was built, how we assess the condition, and the recommendation. So there are two schools that were saying no work is required. That was Yavapai and ANLC. We have one school for heavy renovations. We have the majority, 10 of the schools are light renovation or possible building addition. And then there are 6 sites that could be potential rebuilds should the community, the district, and the board decide that that's the right thing to do. So, what are your options? Option one is to do nothing. Option two is right-size the schools and provide the appropriate learning environments. And by that I mean appropriate learning environments. Today, if you take the light blue, those classrooms are not being utilized 100%. So instead of them utilizing it for one teacher, one student, a full classroom, that means building smaller rooms. Right-sizing, again, depends on the situation. Maybe making the school smaller, maybe making the school bigger. Option three is consolidating schools. Option four is other ideas. That's up for you guys. So what are the pros and cons of option one, doing nothing? Well, your facilities are going to continue to age. Your energy costs are going to continue to be high. The spaces may not necessarily be appropriate for the learning environment. You're going to have extra space as you do today. And that's really about it for option one. Option two, right-size schools and provide appropriate learning environments. Again, rebuild a school based on the projected enrollment. The pro to this is you maintain your neighborhood schools if that's important. The facility would support the learning environment. They'd be energy efficient. Your maintenance would be reduced, and you would have less excess space. Option three, consolidate schools. Obviously, this would have multiple variations, so you have to look at all the scenarios. You may have to reconfigure your boundaries, your grade levels, and probably the downside is there might be fewer schools in neighborhood schools. Option four are other ideas. So that's where we want you to fill in that questionnaire and put your comments below, because maybe there's something that we haven't thought of. And so we'd like to make sure we are able to take that information back to the governing board. So you wonder, what are we doing here today? Well, one thing I think you've seen through the slides is there is a lot of excess space out there in the elementary schools. And the question is that space appropriate for the learning today? Number two, the SFB guidelines, which is State Facilities Board, were developed in the 1990s. I can tell you, because we were designing schools back then, it's based on square foot per student. If we apply that rule to your schools, your utilization would be even lower than what we've shown it to be. Teaching approach has changed back since 1960 when some of these buildings were designed. Obviously, technology has come into play. We've got a lot of special education classrooms that we need to address, and then the emphasis is now more on small learning. And then the other thing that is happening is online assessments are going to be requiring dedicated space. So maybe those computer labs that were going away because we saw all the laptops and everything coming in the classrooms, we're still going to have the computer labs because you're going to need a place for those online assessments. So, in closing, we want you to prioritize what's most important to you. So again, as a recap, option one is to do nothing. Option two is to right-size schools and provide an appropriate learning environment. Option three, consolidate schools. Option four could be a combination of the option above or other ideas. So please fill out. We're going to hand out the handouts now. We ask that you fill them out. Again, as a reminder, if you have any additional thoughts, please feel free to send them to the email address at SUSD, E is in elementary, M is in master, P is in plan, at admgroupinc.com. So thank you, And we will open up for questions. We will be taking the microphone to you so that everybody else can hear your questions.